Welcome back. Let's turn to a regular feature I call Red News, Blue News. I wore purple today for the occasion. Let me explain what I want to do with it. There are very important issues, ones that face all of us, that get turned into ugly slugfests by partisan networks and websites. Right-leaning or left-leaning talking heads put their own spins on stories until it's almost impossible to figure out what's true. And they end up creating bitter divisions in our country. The most dramatic example of red news, blue news that I can think of is Obamacare. Nothing else even comes close. This week, the White House announced that it had reached a goal many had thought was way out of reach. More than 7 million people signed up for Obamacare by the March 31st deadline. To a lot of people, this sounded like very good news, but not at Fox News. There were anchors and commentators who said it was all a lie. Watch how Jesse Waters does it in this clip. He calls President Obama a liar, but never actually invokes his name. Instead, he does it by calling out the White House repeatedly.
I actually think the White House is straight up lying about these numbers. They're saying 7 million people signed up on the website that was broken for the last 9 months. They really want us to believe that this website's working enough where they can give us a legitimate number. The White House has lied about so many things. Why wouldn't they lie about this?
The whole thing is a ruse. I think they don't really care how many people signed up, they being the Obama administration. It's just basically a stop on the way station to full government control of the medical industry.
So what do you think is worse, that or the celebrating that they seem to be doing over at MSNBC? Check this out.
Fox News has to be feeling about this tall tonight. Actually, they are so far away from the American people and what the needs and the desires are of our society. They're in their little bubble, and they're about this tall when it comes to their knowledge on healthcare, and they have less belief in the American people. It is amazing. This is a huge night for this man right here.
That 7.1, that 7 million number, that is not just something that critics of health reform and critics of the president said would never be met. It wasn't just Republicans saying that 7 million number, which it became a 6 million revised number, would never be met. It's not just something Republicans said would never happen. It is something that the Beltway press said would never happen.
Now, I've said a bunch of times on this program that I'm glad Fox News and MSNBC both exist as point of view news channels. But I think these segments about Obamacare cry out for more reporting, less presuming. Now, CNN's sometimes guilty of this too, of taking a hot button issue and turning it into a Punch and Judy show where you put a liberal on one side, you put a conservative on the other, and let's go at it. And that's exactly what I'm going to do right now, but with a twist. Let's bring in on the left, in New York, Mark Lamont Hill, a CNN political analyst and host of Huffington Post Live. And on the right, in Dallas, Ben Ferguson, a radio host and CNN commentator. Both join me now, but I'm going to ask you two to forget your political leanings for a moment and address this issue like regular people. Welcome to both of you.
Good to be here.
Good to be here.
A lot of people don't follow this issue as closely as the three of us do. So, Ben, let me start with you. What is it about this policy issue that so deeply divides people?
Well, it's divisive because there's a lot of people that thought this was going to be simple and easy, and it turned out not to be. We know that just from the number of delays. We know that from the problems with the website. We know that with people that weren't able to keep their doctor or even their hospital in their neighborhood that they used to go to. People don't like change. They really don't like it when it comes to their personal health insurance or getting a cancellation notice or being forced to sign up for something.
Mark, do you agree that's the reason why this issue is so divisive?
To a large extent, yes. Ben said people don't like change. I think that's true, but they do like the benefits of change. So you see people, and poll numbers bear this out for the last few years, who don't like Obamacare, but they like every benefit that Obamacare offers, from covering pre-existing conditions to allowing their children to stay on their health care plans longer. And so there's this huge divide because the public is saying to themselves, we think we're not supposed to like this, but we kind of do. And as Ben said, it's been a messy rollout, which complicates things even further.
What do you like about it, Ben? Name one thing for me that you like about it.
Well, I like the pre-existing condition aspect of it. I certainly think that's something that's very important and a lot of conservatives were in favor of.
And Mark, I'm sure there's something you don't like about the giant law known as Obamacare.
Not at all. I think it's flawless. No, I think, obviously, as a practical matter, the rollout was just disastrous and it was totally foreseeable. But in terms of the actual policy, I've been a single-payer person from the beginning, and I think what we are getting is essentially universal health insurance, not universal health care, which I think could make things more bloated and puts money in the coffers of these big corporations, which I find troublesome.
my big question is this, and the White House still, as of today, has not answered this question. How many of the people they're claiming have signed up have actually paid for their first month of insurance? Because if you don't pay, if you went onto the system, you filled out a form, but you don't pay for the service, you're not insured.
That's a different argument, Ben. The argument, the dominant right-wing narrative has been that given the dysfunctional website, given the lack of young people who want to enter this healthcare plan, that there actually isn't a number of people that we can verify who actually signed up. What you're saying is people may have signed up, but we don't know if it's going to stick. That's a different argument than saying the White House is actually making up people, that we're actually just producing false numbers. That's a different
thing. I'll put it this way. This is like when I take a test back in the good old days of school and your parents say, how'd you do? And I said, oh, I did fine. I aced it. Well, guess what? The real number when it comes in is what you actually did. And that's the number that you get judged on. And we as Americans should be looking at the White House saying, okay, you can give us this exciting number. How many paid? That's the only number that should actually matter. And did people really sign up by paying?
Journalistically, that is the long-term story here. The one that we won't know answers to for a long time. And maybe that's one of the challenges when it comes to media coverage, whether it's partisan or whether it tries to be objective, of this story. It's that we won't really know the outcomes for a long, long time.
No, that's true. But the problem is in this news cycle, people are eager to get an answer within minutes. And so immediately after the rollout, people are saying, oh, the rollout is a success. Everything's working fine, despite the fact that the website was dysfunctional. And on the other side, people were saying, oh, the website is a disaster. There's no way the Obama administration can get the adequate number of people signed up. We jumped to a quick story when, in fact, we need to let this thing play out. And as it's played out, we see that 7 million was, in fact, attainable. The next question that Ben raises is, will these numbers stick? Will people pay that bill? Will these numbers increase? And will, as the CBO projects, will we get down to a lower number of maybe less than 50% of people uninsured by 2017? It's doable.
I think it also comes back to an issue of trust. I remember the day when Kathleen Sebelius was in front of Congress and she's saying the White House and this website is working smoothly. At the exact moment, the website is down. And even the president made fun of himself on how bad of a debacle it's been. And then until they start to have consistency and truth in numbers, truth in the website working, Americans are still going to be very skeptical of Obama.
If by Americans you mean Fox News, if by Americans you mean conservative media outlets.
Well, I'm not Fox News. I'm CNN.
I know you're not Fox News, but what I'm saying is the dominant narrative that we hear is that people don't trust it. I haven't heard people say that. I hear news outlets say that. I'm not convinced that they're one and the same.
Mark, what does it say about the liberal media or about the objective media that the conservative media's narrative has stuck so well about this program?
I think it says everything about liberal media's inability to produce a strong counter-narrative.
You mean channels like MSNBC? You mean...
Yes, that's exactly what I mean. I think MSNBC hasn't produced a strong counter-narrative, and I think the right has always been much more organized in their messaging. For the last 12 months, you've heard nothing but Obamacare can't work, young people won't sign up, and it's still possibly going to be repealed when none of those things were actually true. I haven't heard the same... I haven't seen MSNBC come an equal force to Fox
News.
Now, the truth is, I don't want either narrative. What I want is a CNN narrative, a straight narrative of objective analysis. But if we're going to be partisan, at least let it be on equal footing.
It's not the media, per se, spinning it. It's the American... People are experiencing the cancellation, and they're saying that their doctor, they can't keep them. That is real life for Americans. That has nothing to do with the media.
Let me read from E.J. Dion's column in the Washington Post a couple of days ago and have you all react. He wrote this, from now on, will there be more healthy skepticism about conservative claims against the ACA? Given how many times the law's enemies have said the sky was falling when it wasn't, will there be tougher interrogation of their next round of apocalyptic predictions? Mark, given what you know about the media, do you think there will be more skepticism next time?
The conservative media has argued that the sky is falling for 9 to 12 months. They've told us that the policy won't work. They told us that people won't sign up. They told us that it's likely to be repealed. None of those things turned out to be true, yet we bought into them. Even places like the AP were pushing this as something that will require someone to nearly walk on water for a 6 million sign-up to happen. It just wasn't true. We need to be more skeptical.
Ben, I'm guessing that you do think the sky did somewhat fall even if these numbers turn out to be right.
Well, I mean, skepticism is always a good thing, but there are also facts that are indisputable here, and that is that the president said, if you like your doctor, you can keep it. That's not true. The president said, if you like your plan, you can keep it. That also is not true. And the president has come out and said the website was working when, in fact, it wasn't working, including Kathleen Sebelius. And then they don't know why it wasn't working.
I think that's where we leave it. Mark Lamont Hill, Ben Ferguson, thank you both for being here.
Pleasure.
Thanks for having us.